The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3584 in the name of Ruth Maguire. It's on welcoming Play Scotland's play charter, and the debate will be concluded without any questions being put. May I ask those members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Ruth Maguire to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms. Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking all of the MSPs from right across the chamber who signed the motion allowing this debate to take place, and all of those who have stayed to participate or to watch the debate. I need to make a special mention also of some play champions in my own constituency, St Luke's Primary and Early Years in Colwinning. I visited the school on Friday and was hugely impressed by their commitment to play. One of the early years pupils, Finn, gave me a brilliant guided tour of their junkyard garden, of which they're all rightly proud. Thank you, Finn. I also extend a warm welcome to all of our visitors in the public gallery, particularly Marguerite and Sharon from Play Scotland. I'm grateful for all the good work they do encouraging play and look forward to joining with them and their colleagues after the debate for a reception in Committee Room 5. Members are, of course, encouraged to join us. Presiding Officer, this debate is about the importance of play and of children's right to play. Growing up in the 80s, or the olden days, as my daughter calls it, the opportunity to be outside playing was something my friends and my brother and I took for granted. Exploring on our bikes, building ramps, bogies, and games of Kirby that went on all day, we also used to play our favourite TV games. The Fall Guy, being the one I remember vividly, involved us trying our best to emulate Colt, Howie and Jodie, climbing and jumping off things. I don't remember any serious injuries, but I do remember the occasional gentle warnings shouted by our mums to get off the garage roof and that someone was going to end up breaking something soon. Presiding Officer, the Minister tweeted a picture of some magnificent chalk art on his street the other day and it brought a smile to my face. Another thing we used to play when we were younger, and I hadn't seen that since my girls were young. Another great play activity that provided hours of amusement for them. The UN definition of children's play is any behaviour, activity, or process initiated, controlled, and structured by children themselves. It takes place whenever and wherever opportunities arise. In other words, it's what children and young people do when they follow their own ideas and interests in their own way and for their own reasons. It's also frequently heard described as what children and young people do when they're not being told what to do by adults. Play is an essential part of every child's life. It's vital for the enjoyment of childhood, as well as for social, emotional, intellectual, and physical development. The importance of play was unequivocally recognised when it was enshrined as a right of the child in the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, which came into force in 1990. Article 31 of that convention states that children have the right to relax and play and to join in a wide range of cultural, artistic, and other recreational activities. This article was lent even more force in 2013 when the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child adopted a general comment that clarifies and underlines for governments worldwide the meaning and importance of Article 31, as well as their obligations to promote, protect, and fulfil children's rights to play by means of appropriate legislation, planning, and budgets. Part of the comment says that while play is often considered non-essential, the committee reaffirms that it is a fundamental and vital dimension of the pleasure of childhood, as well as an essential component of physical, social, cognitive, emotional, and spiritual development. The fundamental value of play is also recognised by the Scottish Government, which launched Scotland's first national play strategy in 2013. This strategy recognises the life-enhancing nature of play and affirms a commitment to enabling all children and young people to realise their right to play, in particular through facilitating sufficient space and time for play, and to promoting positive support for play. Yes, I would.
Liam MacArthur.
Could I thank Ruth Maguire for taking an intervention and actually for bringing the debate to the Parliament? The point she made about providing the facilities and the time for play, I think, is an essential one. One of the feedback I get locally is around a sort of deterioration in those facilities, in play parks, for example. Is there more that can be done liaising between Scottish Government and local government, do you think, to ensure that those facilities are maintained so that enjoyment can be provided?
Ruth Maguire.
I thank Liam MacArthur for that intervention. It sounded a bit more like a question for the government than for me. I guess what I'd say is it's not always about play equipment, it's about space and time, and that can be making sure that the green spaces that we have outside are accessible. And I would say that one of the most depressing things you can see is a no ball game sign on a bit of pristine grass that looks perfect for football. The Play Charter describes our collective commitment to play for all children and young people in line with Article 31 of the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child, and builds on both the Scottish Government's play strategy and the GIRFEC approach to supporting children, young people and their families. This charter is hugely important in positively promoting play and in providing a clear reference and rallying point for all those with an interest in and responsibility for play. Presiding Officer, I'd like to conclude by encouraging all MSPs who signed the motion to also consider pledging their support to the Charter and becoming play champions, and encourage relevant individuals and organisations in their own constituency to pledge their support to the Play Charter too. And let's do all we can to make sure that the children and young people in the communities we serve can enjoy all the wonderful opportunities to play that we did. It's their right.
Before we go on any further, can I ask those in the public gallery, whilst I know they will appreciate some of the things said, not to clap after each speaker. I'll give you the opportunity at the end when the meeting closes to show any appreciation. And I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Presiding Officer, and may I thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this debate to the Chamber and giving us the opportunity to discuss what everybody in the Chamber already knows is a topic very close to my heart and which I'm extremely passionate about. Now, I've said many times in this chamber that education is a major solution to health and welfare. A key element of that education is physical literacy and its impact on health inequality and the attainment gap. I maintain that we cannot close the attainment gap nor close the health inequality gap, both physical and mental, without fully addressing the physical literacy deficit that exists in tandem with other inequalities. From a physiology perspective, and can I just get this out of the way first, we know that cardiovascular system, neuromuscular system, bone density, neural pathways important to speech and listening skills and behavioural traits, attention capacity, etc., are all established pre-school. And I also think we all intrinsically understand that if a child is given the opportunity to be active outside the classroom, they're more likely to have a positive behavioural traits inside the classroom, are more likely to engage in the classroom and are therefore more likely to achieve. You see, Deputy Presiding Officer, we seem to be increasingly obsessed with making our children sit still all the time. It's unnatural. Part of the brain switches off in youngsters if they're forced to sit still for too long without any physical activity. Children are not built to sit still. Good grief, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm not built to sit still. I would be in constant trouble if part of your remit was to get MSPs to sit still with their arms crossed and sit up straight. There'd be a naughty step in which I lived on all the time. So this brings us to the importance of active play, especially in the early years. As I've said before, youngsters want to move about a lot with their peers. In doing so, they set patterns for life. They learn interaction skills and confidence and resilience and self-awareness, awareness of others. All behaviours that are much more difficult to learn sitting still in a nursery or a classroom, yet have a huge influence in outcomes from the classroom. And we haven't gotten this right yet. We need to consider how we give every child the opportunity for outdoor and indoor play, climbing and jumping in puddles if necessary, falling down, getting back up, catching, throwing, and all the other ways they can invent to learn in their own way. This is the blueprint for life. This is the way in which we tackle preventable health, the way in which we stack the cards in our favour. The way we give ourselves a better opportunity to tackle the obesity crisis or diabetes or musculoskeletal issues or chest, heart and lung issues, not to mention rising mental health issues, all of which are disproportionately affect the most disadvantaged in our society, and apart from anything else, cost our NHS billions of pounds. This is also what I mean when I talk about behavioural drivers. I advocate that if we could get our youngsters active at the earliest opportunity and give them the pathway to remain active all through the school years, the chances of them choosing not to smoke, choosing not to take up alcohol, or be overweight, or eat well, or have good mental health is hugely increased. We have to look at access of this kind of opportunity and the barriers to participation and then break them down. I had the power chair footballers from Ayrshire Tigers in the Parliament today, and I know I've mentioned them often in this chamber and the fact that they hammered the MSP team last year. And if you ever want to understand what having an opportunity to participate means and the impact it can have on lives, speak to them. They are just the most amazing group of people. Participation has taken them out of isolation and into mainstream. And this all starts from access to active play and the premise that it's every child's right to play with their friends, get dirty, be noisy, be sociable, irrespective of background or personal circumstance. All the things that we took for granted when we were kids. In my view, it's the basis of solving many of the issues we see in our society today. And in my humble opinion, and once again, I thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this debate to the chamber and allowing me another chance to rant once again on my very favourite topic. Thank you.
You know, I'm liking the idea of a naughty step.
What is...
Rona Mackay, followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my colleague Ruth Maguire for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. Presiding Officer, children have a right to play, as enshrined in Article 31 of the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child, as Ruth outlined. But it's much more than that. We all know that play is what teaches our children social skills, how to compromise, be tolerant and resilient. Play is the universal language of childhood. Even young animals play. We buy our dogs, cats, rabbits and hamsters toys, and the benefits simply cannot be overstated of play in the developing years. However, not all children are lucky enough to be given the encouragement to play or be bought toys most children come to expect. As a former children's panel member, I saw children who were so neglected and starved of attention they had to be taught how to play, and it was then I realised what an important part of a child's development play is. Since 1998, the benefits of Play Scotland's inclusive strategic approach have been significant. It aims to ensure that no child is left out. The Play Charter challenges barriers and ensures discrimination and stigma based on age, gender, disability, ethnicity, poverty or low income has no place in affecting children's play experiences to ensure all children feel included. The benefit to children and young people's physical, emotional and mental health is immense, as outlined by Brian a moment ago. They're able to develop social skills and responsibility, appreciate the environment and participate in sports, art and culture. This grows their identity and self-esteem and in turn makes them less likely to offend and engage in social behaviour in later life. I welcome this positive development, building on both the Scottish Government's National Play Strategy and the Getting It Right for Every Child approach to supporting children, young people and their families. The Play Charter's commitment to training adults so they can support high-quality play experiences in a variety of places where children play is also hugely positive. These can range from nurseries and childcare, schools, children's services, out-of-school clubs and holiday schemes. And it works towards ensuring high-quality play experiences across key areas that contribute to children's development and growth, and that affects their daily life experiences. The Charter supports children's participation in the planning, developing and evaluating of play services, recognising them as the play experts and seeking out their views. Of course, this ensures that children and young people are engaged and that the Play Charter is reflective of their interests and needs. Play Scotland's campaigning through the Play Charter to ensure that play is more strongly embedded within policies, strategies and key qualifications is welcome in making sure that we do get it right for every child. To conclude, Presiding Officer, we must all encourage our children to play and create the correct environments, indoors and outdoors, where they can do this. It is our responsibility. This is not a luxury for our children. It is, in my view, essential to the health and well-being of future generations. So I wish Play Scotland continued success in its campaign. We'd be happy to be a play champion. And I wish them well in raising the awareness of the benefits of play and providing inclusive play experiences for children right across Scotland.
I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I too would like to give my thanks to the member for bringing forward this debate, not least because it gives me yet another opportunity to talk about my children in the Chamber, and it's always a delight to do so. And one of the sort of the most recent innovations in my household is that my 18-month-old daughter has taken to leaving the sitting room, pulling the door behind her, going, bye-bye. A couple of moments later, a wee smiley face pops around there going, hello. And I think that sort of demonstrates the importance of play, because by doing this, my daughter is exploring language, learning how to use words, and what's more, having a wee laugh as she does it. And I just think that encapsulates just how important play is in the development of children. And indeed, I think we're right to talk about the importance of Article 31, about the right to relax and play and take part in cultural and artistic activities. But it's actually much more important than that, because it's actually about how our children learn. Indeed, this isn't new. You know, the insight that children need to play in order to learn goes back to the early 20th century. Indeed, you know, it's well demonstrated the importance of play in terms of children's cognitive, emotional development, their ability to self-regulate, and indeed their ability to develop and learn language. The 16 most powerful predictors of children's academic achievement are based around how well they learn to play as children. And that's why it's so concerning, the fact that the children's area where they're allowed to range and play unsupervised has shrunk by 90% since the 1970s. So that's why this debate is important, because we need to talk about these issues, not just because it's our children's right, it's because it's what our children need in order to learn. So I'd like to talk briefly about a scheme that I visited and took part in Edinburgh, the Playing Out scheme. And last year, through the frenetic activity and lobbying of a group of parents, there were a number of roads which were closed for a single day in Edinburgh so that children could come out and play. And it was fantastic. There was chalk drawings on the pavements. There were bicycle races going up and down the road. And what's more, there were also parents sitting, standing, talking, drinking coffee, sharing home baking. So there were huge benefits, not just to the children, but to the adults and the communities that they lived in. So that what has happened this year is that has turned into a pilot. So there's a five-month-long pilot ranging from April through to August, where local streets can have five dates within that period. The council's prepared a simple checklist and application form, and it's free for parents to apply for this. Now, I think that demonstrates a simple thing that can be done, that addresses many of the challenges, that enables parents to take the initiative themselves and makes it easy for them to. And I think it's exactly the sort of thing that we should be looking at. So I think we should welcome the Charter. I think it sets out a number of great things. But I think the key thing is that we need to ensure that these actions are embedded within policy. The play strategy that has been set out by the government is right, but we also need to set out the challenges. One in six children in Scotland do not have access to outdoor space. 85% of children in Scotland say they do not spend enough time engaged in free play. And over 1,000 Scottish schools have no access to outdoor facilities. So we have to not just put the warm words and support the actions. We need to set the challenges for government. Now, this is a consensual debate, and I think it should remain that. But when we talk about facilities, we need to talk about local services and the impact of local funding. So we must have some innovation, and things like Playing Out will come at little cost to local government. But we should also look towards whether or not we should be opening up our schools in summer holidays to enable play and also address childcare through summer holidays. But we also need to talk about local services, because if we're going to have accessible, stimulating parks for our children to play in, that does require investment and that does require funding to local services. So I would thank the member for bringing forward this debate. This is a hugely important topic. I think we should all champion play, but let's also have some challenge to government, and let's have some action, let's have some investment.
Alison Johnson and then Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I share Daniel Johnson's approval of the play-out days. I actually chalked on Abbotsford Crescent. And the thing about the play-out day, the street was closed. It didn't just attract children. There were people out there from toddlers to 80-year-olds. It turned the street into a place for people. I'd really like to thank Ruth Maguire for securing this debate. It's a really important issue because we all can do more to safeguard and promote the rights of children. And the right to play is absolutely central to children's experience. We know that challenging active play is essential for children's health and well-being. But when we look at rates of childhood obesity in this country and others, it's clear that we can and we must do better. And a recent study by the University of Strathclyde showed that children's level of physical activity begins dropping off as early as 7. So we have much to do. We need to develop, we really need to push for a more child-friendly, play-centred society, and that requires a cultural shift. Ruth Maguire spoke about the no ball game sign in a little cul-de-sac just down the road from where I stay. This cul-de-sac was tailor-made for children's play, but one morning residents woke up and, hey, what was there? A no ball game sign. And it took quite a lot of work to have that sign removed. And how many children's sporting skills and physical activity have been held back by that kind of intolerant attitude? So developing more child-centred communities is crucial. And we have to put this at the heart of any planned expansion in childcare in Scotland. Make sure our nurseries have got adequate outdoor space. My colleague John Finney shared a photo on Twitter recently, a sign, Play Street from 4 p.m. till sunset. Well, if you could have found any space to play in between the parked cars, you're, you know, more able than I am to imagine how you would play in that busy urban space. We also, there are simple things, simple steps we can take. If we had space for wellies and waterproofs and they were provided as a matter of course in our primary school changing areas, there wouldn't be such things as an indoor break time because it was a little wet. And we all know the impact of children who are just bursting with energy and how difficult it is for them to sit down and focus. It's not fun for teachers, it's not fun for pupils. And I think that we can all agree that children's needs have rarely been at the heart of planning processes. Article 12 of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child gives children a right to be consulted, for their views to be given due weight and to be heard in matters that affect them. But how often are they truly involved in consultations about residential developments and planning decisions about places where they can play? The space afforded to play areas in some developments is meagre, and their design is dull, to put it politely. The play area closest to my home, to be honest, you'd have to have the hands of probably, you know, a man of 6'5" to be able to hold on to the bars. And it would never have been designed if toddlers had been asked what they'd like to see. That said, there are some excellent examples of challenging play spaces for children and their families. I'd like to mention the fantastic play project, The Yard, here in Edinburgh, and it shows how inclusive play can be. And I'm glad that Scotland's Play Charter stresses that we must promote inclusive play, ensuring that our play environments meet the needs of children with disabilities too. But sadly, it remains the fact that too many children in Scotland don't have appropriate access to places to play. Good quality housing plays a part here too. Too many new homes lack adequate space for children to play indoors or out. You know, who's got room for a sand pit or a little water table in a small two-bedroom flat? And we know that, well, Shelter Scotland's recent report showed that families with children in temporary accommodation spent almost 1 million days in that accommodation last year. 13% of families with children who needed temporary accommodation were there for longer than a year. And those children are being badly failed on their right to play in their homes. Playing outdoors, Presiding Officer, I will begin to wind up. It's more difficult than it should be. Traffic poses a real barrier to outdoor play. A 20 mile per hour speed limit across all built up areas would make it much safer and would also improve air quality. I'd just like to finish by mentioning that Article 31 established the right to play for all children and young people aged up to 18. And I would ask the Scottish Government in any work going forward that they don't forget that, you know, the right to play and explore your environment and socialise doesn't stop at 10 or 12 or 15. It goes on. So let's all work together to promote the Charter and the right to play. Thank you.
Before I call Mr Gibson, there's still quite a few members who wish to speak in the debate, so I'd be happy to accept a motion without notice, and that's under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. So I invite Ruth Maguire to move that motion without notice.
Happy to move that motion, Presiding Officer.
The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is then agreed. I now call Kenneth Gibson, who will be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Presiding Officer, I too would like to thank Ruth Maguire for lodging this motion and for bringing Scotland's first play charter to the Chamber. For years, experts from health and education have called for an inclusive formal play charter to help ensure that every child in Scotland is given the opportunity to play, explore and develop. And today, thanks to Play Scotland, this charter is now a reality. We all know the importance of play in developing happy, healthy, well-rounded young children. From our Getting It Right from Every Child approach to the Play Strategy Action Plan, play is at the heart of guaranteeing the well-being of children. And we want Scotland to be the best place for children to grow up in. By supporting the Play Charter, we can show our commitment to this valuable cause. And as the debate has progressed, Presiding Officer, I've been thinking back to my own childhood, particularly up until the age of 8 when I lived in Kelvin Grove, when I spent a lot of time building dens and climbing trees. Also spent a lot of time in disused railway tunnels, sneaking into through tunnels the old Sweetie Factory in Kelvin Grove and looking for tunnels under the York Hill Hospital when I wasn't actually digging them, and also digging for treasure under Glasgow Art Gallery before sneaking in to count the nipples on the statues, as young boys invariably do. I have to say my tunnelling didn't extend quite to the Steve McQueen extent of trying to get a motorbike over the Swiss border, but I can say that my childhood was extremely adventurous, and I tried when I became a father to ensure that continue with my own children, taking them into the forest to look for trolls, which are a notorious problem in the campsies in particular, and of course taking them river rafting, canyoning, etc., and wrestling with them as often as possible, something my wife criticised me heavily for until a Sunday Times article pointed out the importance of rough and tumble between fathers and in particular male children, although I have to say my daughter was much more violent and unforgiving than either of her two brothers. So the benefits of play, I believe, are huge, and I think that's been well proven, not just for ourselves, but also our communities. And if we look at what's going on in our communities, we can see play still forms an integral part of life for young people and among children of all backgrounds. And I think it's important that children do have the freedom to construct their own play. I take, for example, Eggington Country Park Inclusive Play Area, which was opened in North Ayrshire in 2011. This space is available for children and young people, boys and girls of all physical, mental and social abilities, and was designed in consultation with four special needs schools in North Ayrshire, and by listening to what children really wanted, a space to allow them to develop and explore the world in their own way, and that has been successfully created and opened. This project sheds light on what Scotland's Play Charter is all about. Inclusive play means no child is left behind, and we should continue to address the barriers which prevent children from enjoying play, no matter the circumstances. And I hope to see other such projects flourish throughout my constituency and across Scotland. As we know, the right of children to relax and play is formally enshrined in the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, ratified by the UK in 1991. And under that convention, children have a right to play regardless of age, gender, disability, ethnicity and socioeconomic background. And I'd like to thank Play Scotland for doing such an excellent job in increasing importance of play to the development of children and young people in our country. And I welcome the fact 88% of households now have access to some form of play area in their neighbourhood, but more could clearly be done, particularly for the 12% who do not have access to ensure play areas accessible, safe and inclusive for all. I'm heartened to see many fellow MSPs have already pledged themselves to Scotland's Play Charter and hope that many more will join the list in the coming weeks. We can demonstrate our commitment to play in our policies and strategies, inspire individuals, play providers and organisations to promote a range of play activities inclusive for all children. Presiding Officer, I look forward to working with Play Scotland to find further opportunities to remove barriers to inclusive play in my Cunninghame North constituency to help ensure we really do get it right for every child. Regardless of whether children play on their own or with friends, whether play is loud, boisterous, quiet and contemplative, whether it's spontaneous and creative or serious and strategic, it's time for us all to take play much more seriously in our homes, our schools and our communities.
I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Deputy Presiding Officer, one of my favourite programmes when I was growing up was Why Don't You? And it was a programme which challenged you to switch off the television and go and do something more useful instead. And it gave you lots of ideas about how to play. And actually, that was really important for me and my younger brother as we were growing up, because suddenly our world was given a new horizon, that we could go into our back garden and not see it as a back garden only, but see it as many different things and many happy hours played there. But I wonder if I could just touch on a slightly different area in regard to this. And I also welcome Play Scotland here this evening, and I apologise that I won't be coming to the reception, because I'm going to rush off to play with my children at home after this. But I think there is an area there that some parents do not know how to play with their children or how to encourage their children to play. And I was struck when my two young girls were just slightly younger. We used to go on a Saturday morning to an organisation called Dad's Rock here in Edinburgh. And Dad's Rock was set up for one purpose, and that was to encourage fathers to play with their children. Because I still think there's a legacy going back many decades where fathers do not interact and play with their children, perhaps as well as their mothers. And this organisation on a Saturday morning simply brought together children and fathers and gave the tools and the framework to learn to play. And it worked really well. Not only were we allowed a snack, which my wife would never let us have at home, but we actually got to play with toys and boots and given a framework of how to do that. The only sad thing about that was that where it was placed was in a more deprived part of this city. But it was middle-class people coming in from middle-class areas that benefited from this free service. And when we're talking about play, I think we need to look how do we encourage all fathers and mothers from whatever background they come from to be able to interact and to take that time to play with their children. We all live very busy lives. We all have emails to respond to. We all have work to do in the house. We all have pressing demands upon us. And I suspect for too often, playing with our children drops down that agenda. And I think we need to give a message that actually, if the washing isn't done up quite when it should be done, or if that doesn't happen just when it shouldn't happen because you were playing with your children, well, that was a sacrifice worth making. The second area I want to cover very briefly, Deputy Presiding Officer, has already been mentioned by two members, a marriage playing out here in Edinburgh. I too attended that event last year. And I think if we can again recapture, even on limited situations, where we can close streets off, roads off, and children can learn again to play on the street with each other, with parental supervision and parental input, then we start to break down those barriers. So I again thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this motion, for highlighting this really important issue, and wish Play Scotland all the best as they move forward, along with other organisations, as we seek to encourage all of us, whether grandparents, parents, uncles, aunts, to play with children and to encourage them to play in appropriate ways. Thank you.
I call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Ian Gray.
Presiding Officer, and I would also like to add my thanks to Ruth Maguire for bringing this debate to Parliament. We as parents can sometimes find it too easy to fear for the safety of our children, and it can become a habit to keep children indoors off the streets. Time feels increasingly scarce, and if you work shifts or are a single parent, it can be a real challenge to send your children outside rather than keep them indoors, especially when you know that a child indoors on their computer or watching TV is safe and secure. But we should not lose sight of the real benefits of play from an early age. For infants, programmes like the Baby Brain Workout, promoted by Bernardo's during last year's Infant Mental Health Awareness Week, identifies play as one of the key pillars of infant learning and emotional development. And as Brian Whittle mentioned earlier, that early interaction is important for the neurobiological development of infants' brains. And when they grow older, children who play outside with others grow into curious, well-adjusted adults who are not only healthier, but develop key social skills. Play stimulates and enhances learning and fosters creativity, meaning that time we value indoors, spent reading books, for example, should be balanced with time outdoors, consolidating learning. Outdoors play is also a great leveller. It allows those who come from more challenging backgrounds to have some of the same stimulation and fun as those from wealthier families. And understanding that children have different abilities and different interests, we should create spaces for play that reflects this. And we should bring children of different interests and abilities together using universal design rather than separating them into over-specialised spaces. Breaking the monoculture of public spaces is a good thing. Not all children are interested in a football pitch or are able to take advantage of the facilities that are focused on able-bodied children. But the biggest obstacle to play, especially in more deprived communities, is a lack of play spaces, as we've heard already from some speakers. In my own constituency of Rutherglen, the redevelopment of Cunninghame Loop has been a fantastic step towards giving everyone the opportunity to play and to reconnect with the outdoors in their own way. It's set up in a 15 hectares of what was derelict land, the size of 15 football pitches, and it's been transformed into a community green space for local people and visitors to get involved, to get active and to be inspired by the outdoors. In the one cohesive space, it has walking and cycling facilities, a workout area, and Scotland's first outdoor bouldering park, as well as picnic and outdoor classroom facilities. It was part funded by the Scottish Government as part of the 2014 Commonwealth Games legacy, and it provides just the sort of opportunities that Scotland's Play Charter is looking to achieve. The Scottish Government has also invested £7 million through Go and Play and Go to Play to support play for children in disadvantaged communities across Scotland. Women's Aid in South Lanarkshire have also received funding from the Go to Play Capacity Building Fund to introduce free play clubs. And these clubs allow primary school aged children who have experienced domestic abuse the opportunity to play with peers in a safe environment. And the organisation also promotes the benefits of play for children from challenging backgrounds. It's through an active commitment to the value of play that we can target mental health, educational attainment, and social mobility. A happy, stimulated, and socially integrated child has a far greater chance of leading a fulfilling and happy life. I, along with this government, believe in the value of play in improving the lives and the life chances of children in Scotland. And, Presiding Officer, that is why I have pledged my support to the Charter and have signed up to become a play champion. And I'd recommend everyone in this chamber do so to support our young people.
I call Ian Gray to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thanks to Ruth McGuire for getting tonight's debate. And I want to start by apologising to her and to the Minister, because I will have to leave before the end of the debate, I think, now to make a constituency engagement. But I did want to say a few words in this debate because of the importance of play in the development and early learning of children. That's something that there's a great deal of research which provides us with certain evidence that is the case. But in my own case, it's something that I've seen, I think, with my own eyes, because in previous jobs, I've seen children and their parents trying to do the best they can in the most difficult of circumstances of war or displacement or really just grinding almost unimaginable poverty. And it is quite remarkable that no matter how difficult the circumstances, children will still find a way to play and a way to exercise their imagination with the most limited of resources that they have. And it is quite important, I think, to understand that this is an international issue. And I know that Play Scotland are part of the International Play Association as well. And in fact, in the last Parliament, the International Play Association's executive on one occasion met here. I hosted a meeting of their board here in the Scottish Parliament to show their interest in what was happening here in Scotland. So it is very much an international issue, this. That's why it appears, of course, in the UN Convention on Rights of the Child in Article 31. But it's right that we look to home and don't assume that because we don't have these particular difficulties that everything is fine, because it's clear from many of the contributions that it's not and that we could do better. And I just wanted to make a couple of remarks on one or two of the issues which have come up. One is that Play Scotland and the Play Charter are very clear that children's right to play is not an add-on. It's something which must be embedded in our approach to parenting and to early learning. And I think that is critical. And I wanted to just mention in the passing the excellent programme in East Lothian, which East Lothian Council run as part of their early learning strategy, and that is Support from the Start. And that's a programme that provides many, many opportunities, particularly in the school holidays, but not solely in the school holidays, for children to play and their parents to learn more about how effective play can be supported. The other thing I wanted to talk about was the importance of places to play, because I do think that that really does matter, and it is a big factor in the concern that many have expressed about the reduction of the opportunity or the capacity or being allowed to play outside in recent years. Daniel Johnson mentioned the concerns about school playing fields being reduced. Again, in East Lothian Council, that's not the case. 86% of our schools do have playing fields. That's the second best in Scotland. But I think the approach of a local authority to their school playing fields actually is then reflected in their approach to the kind of greater community spaces that Claire Hockey was speaking about. And for example, again in East Lothian, tremendous effort by the community group who support Cuthill Park, who have transformed that park and the play opportunities there. And on Saturday, we'll be launching the latest of these, the Woodland Learning Zone. But the last thing I want to say to the Minister is, and I know that it's not really his brief, if perhaps he would talk with his colleague, the Housing Minister, around the way in which new housing developments and the factoring of common land can have a detrimental effect on play areas. Many private housing developments in my constituency do have children's play areas because the planning permission demands that they do. But the developers, having provided that, then pass it on, the ownership of that small packet of land onto the factors, who then sometimes sell it on to somebody else altogether. And so the maintenance of those play areas is very, very difficult to ensure, and often they end up being a blight rather than an opportunity for children.
Fulton MacGregor, followed by Ross Greer.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, and I'm delighted to speak in this debate, and would also like to thank Ruth Maguire for bringing it to the Chamber and giving us all the opportunity to participate. And I, like the other speakers, fully welcome the promotion of Scotland's first inclusive play charter by Play Scotland, and agree that play for all children and young people is, of course, vital. Play is fundamental in allowing children to develop and grow, and is important to the wider aim of tackling social inequalities. We must ensure access to play is equally available to all children in Scotland, as play acts an important role in learning and will aid in closing the attainment gap. And it has been proven, and other speakers have alluded to, that children from lower socioeconomic backgrounds have less access to play due to negative barriers such as a lack of sustainable and safe local spaces. And this is important in an area like mine, where two of the four secondary schools have nearly half of their children enrolled in the most deprived SIMD bracket. I fully believe that play should be offered at all levels, school and all aspects of the community. And I've enjoyed hearing some of the stories about members talking about when they were growing up. And like Ruth Maguire, I too grew up in the 80s. And there was lots of open space to play sports or take part in
physical activity. In an area where I grew up in Coat Dyke, there was a bit that we called the grass. And, you know, everybody just went down there. I spent my whole summer holidays in that bit, you know, from 9 o'clock in the morning right to through till 9 or 10 at night. We played football, Heidi, whatever else we were playing. And now if you go down there, walk down there, there's never anybody playing. And all the no-ball games and signs are up and around. And actually, looking at it, it's a pretty safe and good place to play, and it's such a real shame. A lot of the spaces as well, you know, such as at Dunbeth Park or what used to be Beside, now have 4G pitches on them. Now, these are excellent facilities, and I've used them myself, but often they're unaffordable, particularly for young people. And actually, I received a letter just last week from a 13-year-old at Christen High School, and he and his friends were playing football on the 3G pitch there at the high school. It's actually a 4G pitch, should they say, and they had to be removed. Now, it wasn't the fault of any of the staff that they had to be removed, but the pitch wasn't actually booked by anybody else. And, you know, it sort of begs the question, could we be making better use of these spaces at times when they're not used? Now, I know in North Lanarkshire there's the whole issue of the PFIs with schools and that sort of thing, so that maybe comes into play legal-wise, but I think the general principle is one that we should be trying to make use of all our spaces, because obviously that helps with nurture, development and wellbeing as well, as I've already said, closing the attainment gap. I would like to take the time to mention an organisation in my constituency, Parents Action for Safe Play, who have a purpose-built state-of-the-art playground, which I had the pleasure of visiting last month. They've worked in the area for over the last 15 years to develop and improve play, youth and sports services for local children and young people. And they are run, their motto is that they're run by the local community, for the local community. Their facilities are very impressive, including a soft play area, outdoor ball game, community garden, adventure playground. And the space is enjoyed by the wider community. That's an example of where they're, when they're not using it, they open it up so that people can come in. There's not a locked gate or anything like that. The outdoor facilities are there for everybody to use. And they also provide services for the local neighbourhoods, local community groups and schools in terms of training older children in the schools to become play champions in order for that to be sustainable. So maybe schools will you know, buy into their services for a year or two, and then hopefully that, you know, it can keep on going from there. But it's a really, really good setup. And I was delighted to get an email last week to hear that they had received £120,000 of funding from Children in Need to provide even greater range of opportunities across my constituency. And I will just say very, very briefly before finishing up that I'm also pleased that through the Sevens Locks Wetland Project, there's going to be a new PIPA site in North Lanarkshire at Drumpelier Country Park, a Crannog play unit, which is its first in its kind for Scotland. And I know a lot of work and research has went into this, and it's a very much an enhanced play provision. And the Locks, or Drumpelier Park, as it's known wider, is already a very good tourist place in the area, so maybe more encouragement to come. So I'll finish up just by thanking Ruth Maguire again, and I will have to say that I won't be able to make tonight's reception, not want to be outdone by either Daniel Johnson or Jeremy Balfour, that I too also need to go home and play with my child. Thanks. Cheers.
Just before I call Ross Greer as the last speaker, could I ask all members here to remember and perhaps to pass on to their colleagues and their groups. I find it courteous for members who take part in a debate to stay until the end of that debate unless they have received permission from the presiding officer by note to leave early. Thank you. Mr. Greer is the last of the open speakers.
Thank you, presiding officer. Like colleagues, I'd like to thank Ruth Maguire for having brought the Play Scotland Charter to the Parliament for debate. I'd also like to thank Robin Harper for having helped me prepare for this debate and welcome him back to the Chamber. I hope it's as enjoyable a view from the public gallery as it was in his time here down on the floor of the Chamber. Over the last two decades in Scotland, we've seen some significant advancements in education. Importantly, many are based on an appreciation that the basic skills of reading, writing, and arithmetic need to be supported by strategies that encourage all of our children and young people to be confident, to have good social skills, and enhance their creativity. At the same time, though, we see a host of trends that work against the overall aims of the Curriculum for Excellence, especially the lack of esteem for physical, creative and communication components. Art, music and drama, technical subjects and languages, they're unfortunately always the first victims of budget cuts. And this regressive trend, if allowed to continue, will deprive our youngest children during the very years where they need to learn and develop at their own natural speed, using their own huge curiosity and their motivation to experiment. Restrictions that deprive children of the opportunity to play in the open air, set their own targets, develop their social skills and their ability to relate to others, they're counterproductive and indeed they can be destructive. Listening to other members reminisce about their time playing, I realised that obviously with mine not being that long ago, actually I have a connection with one other member in the chamber though, in that I played with Rowan Mackay's son. We were in the same cub group, which I realised was a risky play to make, and I'm sure I'll suffer for it later on. But it was exactly the kind of outdoor play, exactly the kind of social skills that we were learning through that. And, Presiding Officer, this isn't a fringe debate. This is a debate of vital importance to well-being and social cohesion in Scotland. You can't separate play from the development of language skills. You can't separate it from the development of motor skills. You cannot separate it from developing the kind of risk assessment that all children need to keep themselves safe. Many ambitious parents believe they need to give their children an advantage by beginning formal education as early as possible. But in her book, The Toxic Childhood, Sue Palmer cites evidence from across Europe that a playful approach to language and learning is as effective, and it's often more effective, than an old-fashioned drill and learn regime. Indeed, by the age of 10, the language skills of children who've had the joys of a child-centred education are statistically the same as, or often ahead of, children who've been subjected to the rigours of formal education. All the research, including the UK's current effective provisions of preschool education project, point to the importance of talk arising from children's own interests, of outdoor play, whether it's free or supervised, of music and song, and not till the age of 5 of introducing playfully phonics well before plunging into pencil and paperwork. Finland and Sweden, often cited in this chamber in various debates, where formal education doesn't start till the age of 7, yes, 7, are at the top of the International League for Literacy Attainment, with the additional benefits of a much lower achievement gap between rich and poor and between the genders. I congratulate Play Scotland and Ruth Maguire on bringing the Play Charter to the Parliament for debate this evening. Play Scotland are a great focal point for debate and discussion for professionals and practitioners of early years education in Scotland. And I hope that they continue to push to ensure that we improve what happens for our young people. There are many organisations working outside of and alongside our schools and nurseries, such as the Wildlife Trust, Forest Schools, the John Muir Trust, and Eco Schools, who in their own ways also supplement the kind of work that is being done by early years and preschool teachers. The government should be doing all it can to ensure that we share the joy of nature and the outdoors with children across Scotland. And the Play Charter should give us all the push needed to make sure that that happens.
I now call Mark MacDonald to respond to this debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll do my best to respond to what has been an excellent and wide-ranging debate. And can I thank Ruth Maguire for securing the debate this afternoon and bringing it to the Chamber this evening. And I would also like to thank Play Scotland for their ongoing support for Play and also for helping to facilitate this evening's reception to celebrate Scotland's Play Charter, which I think by the turnout that we've had for this evening's debate, which is a lot more than we often get for members' business debates in this chamber, Presiding Officer, I think demonstrates the strong commitment that exists to Play across Scotland. And that is a commitment that is shared by this government. I want to try and respond to some of the points that have been raised in the debate this evening. Ruth Maguire and Rona Mackay both emphasised the right to play as articulated in Article 31 of the UNCRC. We see this as very important in government as well. That's why we developed Scotland's National Play Strategy in collaboration with the play sector to help us raise the profile of the impact of play and to ensure that Scotland's children achieve their full potential. And we believe that play is central to that. So I would like to take this opportunity to put on record my thanks to the Play Strategy Implementation Group for the working with us to create and enhance those fundamental building blocks that will enable and inform a more playful Scotland where children can realise their right to play every day. I strongly believe the Play Charter will help us to further embed the principles of the Play Strategy, and again I thank Play Scotland for continuing to diligently encourage us to commit to play as an essential ingredient to children's wellbeing. The Play Charter rightly focuses on inclusivity and our shared vision for play. It seeks to improve the experiences of all children and young people, including those with disabilities or from disadvantaged backgrounds. It aims to ensure that all children and young people can access play opportunities in a range of settings which offer variety, adventure and challenge. They must be able to play freely and safely while learning to manage risks and make choices about where, how and when they play according to their age, stage, ability and preference. Brian Whittle spoke of physical literacy, as he often does in this Parliament, and rightly so, and the impact on children's health and well-being. And I believe play is crucial for children's healthy development. A growing body of evidence supports the view that playing throughout childhood is not an innate behaviour, but also contributes to children's quality of life, their well-being, and their physical, social, and cognitive development. I also am firmly of the belief, Presiding Officer, that there is nothing more powerful than the imagination of a child. It can take you anywhere and make you anything. And through investment in play, we are working with families to create spaces and places for that imagination to thrive. Play is, I believe, one of the keys to unlocking the potential of Scotland's children. That's why, as part of our expansion of early learning and childcare to 1,140 hours, per year by the end of the current Parliament, we're working with Care Inspectorate, Scottish Future Trust and others to publish new practice design guidance for all early learning and childcare centres across the sector by this summer, which will include looking at outdoor play provision. We're also running a series of trials, some of which will look at outdoor play, one of them being based here in Edinburgh, looking at the establishment of outdoor nursery provision through a nature kindergarten. And this morning, Presiding Officer, I had the pleasure to go to West College, the Clydebank campus, and speak to early learning and childcare HNC students. And one of the questions that came back to me was about how do we get the public understanding of the importance of early learning and childcare in terms of children's development, and that it's not just about sitting around playing. And I questioned back why we need to have that distinction. Because fundamental to children's development, I believe, is exploratory play. It's how children learn about shapes, textures, colours, words, numbers. And I believe that that is absolutely critical in terms of children's early development. Daniel Johnson spoke of investment. This government continues to invest in terms of play. We have invested over £3 million in this area in this year alone, including funding for Play Talk Read of £700,000, £1.6 million for the Book Bug programme, and £260,000 for Play Scotland, plus a whole host of other initiatives. We've also invested over £3 million since 2012 in Inspiring Scotland's Go to Play Playranger Fund. This fund supports Scottish charities to develop Playranger provision for vulnerable children and disadvantaged groups and to engage them in active outdoor play. Playrangers provide a huge number of benefits, not only for our children, but for parents, communities, by enabling children to play in spaces familiar to them, such as their street or local park, while giving parents peace of mind and encouraging positive interaction between children and the wider community. Alison Johnson mentioned The Yard, who we had a reception in Parliament recently to celebrate their 30th birthday, and I believe inclusive play is very important, and it's something I want to see being encouraged much more widely. I have a concern that it is often an afterthought, particularly for soft play centres, which often run relaxed and inclusive sessions, but do so at what they deem to be quiet times. And the reason these are quiet times is because they're also inconvenient times, and they're just as inconvenient for families with disabled children as they are for other families. And I think there needs to be a recognition in relation to that. She also spoke about consulting children, and I have experience of this from my time as a counsellor. A local play park in my community, which was the one which I used to play in as a child, had fallen into disrepair. And working alongside some of the community workers in the council, we consulted widely with children living around the play area about what they wanted to see done in relation to its redevelopment. A budget was identified, The park was redeveloped and it is now a busy and thriving play area where previously it had been the kind of area that families tended to avoid. So I think there are good examples out there of where children are being consulted in relation to play opportunities. Kenneth Gibson gave us an interesting insight into his own childhood. We'll perhaps leave it there. But also emphasised, I think, the point that play is about freedom and opportunity, and if we restrict that freedom and opportunity, we restrict opportunities for children to fully develop their potential. Jeremy Balfour, I think, made a very important point around the issue around fathers who perhaps don't interact and play with their children, perhaps not until those children are a bit older, and emphasising the importance, I think, of early play and early interaction for fathers to develop those bonds and develop some of those crucial cognitive abilities. Claire Hawkey touched on the various areas in which play has an impact and mentioned mental health, and that is, I think, an area that is worth recognising, particularly when we look at some of the other pressures that children and young people face in our communities today. Ian Gray, I think, highlighted a number of good examples from his own local area in East Lothian, and also asked me to raise an issue with the Housing Minister about ensuring that play areas in new developments are suitable but also suitably maintained going forward, and I can say that I'll be happy to raise that with my colleague Kevin Stewart following this debate. Fulton MacGregor made an important point about how best do we use spaces. It was a point that was also made by Daniel Johnson, I think we do need to look more carefully at how well we are using spaces, how well we are using facilities, particularly some facilities which often sit empty for long periods of time and could be brought into better use with a bit more creative thinking. Ross Greer touched on the importance of nature and the outdoors, and part of what we're doing in relation to the trial that I mentioned in Edinburgh, but also is happening in a number of other areas, is looking at collaborative approaches between, for example, universities. The University of Aberdeen recently ran a scheme alongside a project called We Green Spaces, which was about offering opportunities to children to use the botanic gardens at the university as a place to play and explore. So there are good examples out there of that kind of collaboration, which we want to see and we want to encourage further. So, Presiding Officer, I recognise I've run over time, but I hope I've managed to get everybody in. I recognise that I'm stopping Jeremy Balfour from getting away to play with his children, so I'd better not hold him up any further. The rest of us, I hope, are going to go and join the rest of the individuals in the gallery at the reception later on as we continue to celebrate play and emphasise its importance to the children of Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I've turned my microphone on now. I close this meeting and you may now show your appreciation if you wish.